Welcome to everybody who's here today and those of you who are watching us live on Facebook or will be watching us later on YouTube channel. I'm so glad that you're here joining us one way or the other. A couple things I did want to let you know about today. We still do not have a PowerPoint presentation for you. The projector had some problems on Easter Sunday and we're working on having it repaired. And so hopefully another week or so we will have it. So I think you've got information in your bulletin that will lead you to hymn numbers and so on in the red book. So if you can do that for lyrics to songs, if they're not ones that you already have etched in your heart. Also, just want to let you know that we have adult ed back today, and then that will be the Book of Daniel. You can meet in the conference room after you get your coffee and your goodies, which look delicious. Cheryl baked for us, so don't forget to do that. And then because next week is Mother's Day, there'll be a skip in the series, and then it'll pick back up again the Sunday after Mother's Day. So please take a walk over to the conference room after worship. Also, let's see, there are no cover G's this Tuesday, so those of you who do go and work on the quilts know that you've got a little bit of a break this week. I also want to let you know that we have a yellow attendance sheet in your worship bulletin, and if everyone would take a minute to fill this out, member, regular attendee, or visitor, this lets us know that you were here and also gives you an opportunity to provide us with any changes in contact information. You have an opportunity to list people that you would like us to pray for that are not already on our prayer list that you find in the bulletin. And then you take this, put it to the outside aisle. The ushers will pick that up, and then those prayers will be addressed later on in worship today. Also, let's see, I have a very special privilege of introducing you to our new interim pastor, Pastor Lori Arroyo. She's beginning to preach with us today. We're so excited. So many of you know Lori from times in past when she's been here and substituting for when our pastors have gone on vacation. Council, we are thrilled. Office staff, we are thrilled. So we hope that you will be as well.
Thank you.
We welcome her with just glad hearts.
Thank you. Thank you, Kim. Thank you. Well, good morning and welcome to worship in the name of Jesus Christ, the third Sunday in the season of Easter. I'm going to ask you to stand and we're going to begin with our call to worship. Jesus is risen. We are called and we respond, yes, Lord.
Lift your name on high, Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to name of
us pray. God who calls us, you took Saul and turned him into a completely new direction. You challenged him to become more creative and to help others to know the loving God through a risen Christ. Shape us so that we might be molded to your Lord.
Amen. Amen. You're invited to be seated.
Reading from Acts. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked.
"I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind. He did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called him in a vision. "Ananias?" "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it, placed his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. The word of the Lord.
We hear from the Holy Gospel according to John, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. After Jesus appeared to his followers in Jerusalem, he showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, have you no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and he jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus had appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs."
A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death which he would glorify God. After he said this to him, follow me. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I invite you to be seated, and then young children to come forward for a children's message with Brian. Yeah, yep. Oh, got our faithful few.
Band's getting bigger. There you go. You have an instrument for the day? Or two? That one goes for the A. Oh, here we go. Is she what? A little shaker?
Go get A.
That I do.
All right.
All right, so let's bring my band up here.
Quote, change is hard at first, messy in the middle, and gorgeous at the end. Well, I'm not sure where the quote comes from or who may have said it first, but especially in the past 2.5 so years, I think we could all agree this sounds a little familiar when we're talking about change. As I begin today at Christ Lutheran Church as your part-time interim minister or transition minister, I want to ponder with you a little bit
what change looks like, especially in relationship to the two scripture texts that we hear this morning. But before we look a little closer at Jesus' words to his followers and Saul's dramatic event on the road to Damascus, I want to take a few minutes to just talk about what I mean when we embrace change. For me, it's a new call to ministry in a new setting. I've previously worked as a transition minister with congregations in the Southern California area. And as Kim mentioned, I'm really no stranger to Christ Lutheran Church. As I look out, I see a lot of familiar faces, and I'm delighted to be here. But the truth is, I'll probably only see most of you maybe four or five times a month when you come to Sunday morning worship. So it might help you to get to know me a little bit better, at least in the beginning. And then maybe you'll be a little comfortable to share your story with me. As an ordained pastor in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, to which this church belongs, I have, like I said, filled in for various pastors in the local area, the Southern California area, as pulpit supply, sabbatical coverage, and transition ministers. I am what is affectionately called a second career pastor because for 10 years I worked in business in various companies, and then I went and pursued a Master of Divinity degree, or as some people say, I went off to seminary. And then I accepted a call in Southern California, began at Trinity Lutheran Church in Hawthorne, California. And each time I have accepted a new call to ministry in a different setting, I come with a little bit of trepidation myself because I'm not exactly sure what God is calling me to do. Sure, there are steps to be taken, and there's worship to be planned, and there are meetings to be held, but what is God calling me into? And often I don't find out till well into the work. But each time I heed God's command to go, I feel the promise that God has for each of us through the power of the Holy Spirit. But that's not to say that change is not hard, especially at the beginning of a transition. Whether it be a new job or a new school or moving to a new neighborhood or coming into a church community. It's often been my experience as a transition minister that once the getting to know you period or the honeymoon phase is over and we enter into the middle, things can get a little messy sometimes. Knowing this ahead of time, I think, often helps as we prepare to do the hard work needed to prepare this community for the permanent pastor, that pastor that we trust that God has already chosen. Which brings me kind of to the end of the quote, gorgeous at the end. As my daughter reminded me when I was telling her what I was going to speak about this morning, she said, gorgeous at the end, sometimes. Well, there you go for a 16-year-old, right? Gorgeous at the end, but can't we look forward with hope and promise to that day when a permanent pastor has accepted a call to be your new pastor here at Christ Lutheran Church in Long Beach, California? So, that was kind of on my mind this week as I looked at the texts and prepared for this morning's message. As we look a little bit closer at John's story of the resurrected Jesus on the beach, we overhear this conversation with Simon Peter and Jesus. And what I hear is some deep hurt in both men as they kind of fumble around for a foundation on which they can come together. You see, it's been a bit messy as Jesus reminds Peter of just how short he fell when he denied him three times at the arrest and before the mock trial, and that Peter might yet fall again if he's not careful. We get to overhear this very intimate beach scene. Peter giving an account not of what he has done or what he plans to do, but he tries very hard, we hear that, for him to be in some kind of relationship with the risen Lord. Because after all, that's what Jesus asks. Jesus asks for a relationship with the risen Lord. How can followers be in a relationship with a resurrected Lord? As we'll hear in the coming weeks, it's complicated. Sometimes it's painful, and sometimes it's distressing as the disciples live into this new reality. And what about Saul? We know from previous stories that Saul had a difficult relationship with the Jewish people, and he radically has his life changed on the road to Damascus. He spent a career persecuting those who would choose to follow Jesus. And then all of a sudden, this voice comes to him, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting." And Saul is once again struck down, reminded that all of these victims of his violence, in all their lives, Jesus has been present with them. Jesus reveals to Saul his inability to see past those who are different, to see those he is persecuting as human beings. In confronting Saul, this voice from heaven challenges him to see through new eyes that all people are worthy of respect. Saul was so sure of how he wanted to see Jesus that he insisted with violence that other people see Jesus in that same way. So through this dramatic and disturbing story, we hear and we come to understand the transformation that Saul has. He comes to understand the damage of forcing others to see the world only as he does. Saul's change was so intense that he is given a new name, a new identity, and a new mission. Out of the messiness of this conversion experience comes an outstanding end in his encounter with Jesus. For both Peter and Saul, now Paul, in the midst of their vulnerabilities that often comes with a dramatic change, a new relationship of trusting Jesus allows them to move forward, allows them to go as Jesus would have them and pursue their mission. May that same trust embolden all of us as we work together with a renewed sense of joy and purpose as we engage in the hard work as followers of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Holy God, when we declare our love for you, it calls us into a relationship of trust and obedience with you. When you say, "Follow me," we often do not know which way to go. So we pray for your Spirit's leading in these times of change, especially when the work gets messy. Teach us to place our confidence in you, who is never changing, never failing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please take that, please join me as we proclaim our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. Now please take that posture for prayer that is most comfortable and appropriate for you. We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Your persecutor Saul suffered a great shock on the way to becoming your servant, Paul. Awaken us where we have fallen asleep. Shake us out of harmful habits and destructive attitudes. Show us how to fully employ our best gifts to your glory, risen Lord. Hear our prayer. Lights may not blind us, nor voices thunder in our ears, but the waters of this blue planet are steadily rising, and the effects of our abuse and neglect are unmistakable. Teach us to recognize and heed the warnings that arise before us while we yet can be part of the solution in preserving our cosmic home. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Sometimes the unenviable task falls to us, and you ask us to face what we fear the most. Give us the courage of Ananias, who, though he was terrified, obeyed your command and followed, to the benefit of millions. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. War and division mark our lives and the world that we inhabit, yet we yearn for peace and an end to the walls that divide us. Sustain those serving as first responders in the peace and diplomatic corps and in our nation's military, especially Ryan, Johnny, and Samuel, and Jim. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Make the scales fall from our eyes and restore to us fullness of vision and strength by your Spirit, O God of hope and healing. Send your mercy especially to Justin, Judy, Ione, Sydney, Don, and Francis, Roger, Daniel, Barry, and Janice, Gary and Linda, Marilyn, Terry, Brandon, Cheryl, the Burnt family, Lori, Lois, Zach, Aaron, Byron, Clara and John, Scott, Steve, Charlie and David, Dorcas, Mary and Max, Gretchen, Kristen and Jonathan, Tamara, Alberta, Cindy, Evie, Bobby, Kylie and Crystal, Jody, Doris, Linda, Barb, Katrina, the Lewis family, Sue, Barb, Paul, Peacemaker, Paula, Emily, Christina and Scott, Mary Catherine, J.R., Rachel, Katie, Teresia, Anna, Ed, Teresa, Jessica, Steve and Jenny, as well as those that we name aloud before you now or in the silence of our hearts. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Following the trail blazed by the earliest carriers of the good news, we take our place in the line of redeemed saints, whose joy it is to praise your name forever and share it. Sustain presiding Bishop Elizabeth Eaton, Bishop Brenda Boss, and the pastors and elected leaders of our church in their proclamation of your son's life-giving gift. We remember, too, the vocation of our sister Linda Gawthorne, missionary to the Kogi people of Colombia, and ask for safety and fulfillment in the task you have set before her. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. We also pray for safekeeping for the Joseph family during their travels abroad, and strength and hope for the people of Ukraine. We pray for Brandon, Phil, Melinda, Gail, and Lisa, for continued healing for Charlie Molinari, ongoing prayers for our dear friend Steve, hospitalized for 4 months with COVID. Pray for strength and motivation. Pray for John Thompson, Mark Smith's grandfather, who had a heart attack, and Finn, and Patty and Angie for reconciliation, and Richard for faith. Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
Mighty and merciful God, you have provided us with everything we need to carry out the work before us. Accept our prayers and fortify us for the days to come. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please
the way.
Share a sign of Christ's peace that is comfortable for you.
We will. Let us pray. We all often think we know where we are going when you turn us in a new direction. Steer us toward gratitude, compassion, and generosity so that all may come to know you. Accept these gifts we offer to help further your mission. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy are you, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and this cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Grant us peace.
How about after?
Grant us peace. Grant us peace.
Okay. And if there's gluten free up here, I don't know. Okay. Do you want to take over here?
Thank you.
Please stand. May the Lord bless you and strengthen you with this meal and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.